Bring in the call to worship. Holy Lord, beautiful and dynamic, intimately united as a society of love.
You are our Creator and cause. You are our Savior and King. You are our intercessor and favorite of Jesus.
The Lord of all has called us forth. Our triune God has made us good. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord.
Hallelujah. Praise God's holy name.
Please remain standing for our opening song, Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Seated. Good morning, church. It's good to see you all here and to know that you are all with us virtually this morning. What a wonderful day to worship God. We give thanks for this day and thanks for each and every person worshiping. A couple of announcements I'd like to make. First of all, I don't want anybody to be uncomfortable about masks. We've been having some discussions. If you want to wear your mask, that's perfectly fine. I encourage you to do that so that you're comfortable. If you have your vaccinations and you choose not to wear your mask, that's perfectly fine too. Now the thing I'm confused about is when somebody walks up to me with a mask on, should I put my mask on also? So I'm not sure about that. So if you want me to put my mask on when you come talk to me, you just let me know and I'll be glad to do that. It's right here in my pocket. I'll be glad to do that for you. Whatever works for you. Second thing, we need worship helpers, liturgists, ushers, greeters, things like that. And the sign-up sheet is back there by Lisa, I believe, on the table, and you can go ahead and sign up there. You can also sign up online. So you can go to the church website, and you can sign up online to do those things. The men's breakfast says that it's going to be the first Wednesday of May. It's actually going to be this Wednesday, the first Wednesday of June. So please plan to come 7 o'clock in the morning for men's breakfast. Our witness of generosity today is about UMCOR. UMCOR has been actively working in shelters and other programs on both sides of the border since 2016. While not involved in the political debate, UMCOR is providing humanitarian grants to 17 organizations, totaling over $670,000, including emergency grants that have provided shelters with the means to place those who are tested positive for COVID-19 and other quarantined facilities. They assist with transportation, they provide food, they provide clothing for the recent uptick in arrivals. UMCOR has approved $1.1 million in grants to Church World Service that will help in a substantial program to resettle asylum seekers. Those who are admitted to the country will receive case management from several Methodist-affiliated border agencies. There will be a national call center for asylum seekers, connection with local residents, resettlement affiliates in the United States, assistance in filing asylum, and many other services. We also work with Justice for Our Neighbors, JFON, and they provide legal support for these folks. So as the situation on the border evolves, UMCOR will continue to explore opportunities of welcome and care for the refugees coming into our country, and those who are ultimately admitted to help them become citizens also. As they work worldwide also to help refugees wherever they might be. So we give thanks for that. Let's stand and sing the doxology. Share the peace of Christ with one another. You can go ahead and actually share the peace the way you normally do this week. It's funny how we get trained, isn't it? Everybody stood there and waited for me to tell you what to do. And I forgot that we had been doing that for a moment. So, okay, you may be seated. There are a number of joys and concerns, I'm sure, in your lives this week that we want to lift up. One of the first ones we want to lift up is a celebration of 21 years of service. And it's really Kevin and Michelle. It's really been the both of them. So Norm is going to have something to say and a presentation to make.
I want to say good morning, church family. Kevin and Michelle, would you be kind enough to join me at this time? As most of you know, as Pastor said, Michelle is retiring after 21 years of service. She'll be retiring on June 1st. And in recognition of that, I would like to give them both the certificate of recognition. And I'd like to read it aloud because I feel it summarizes how our church feels. Michelle, this is to recognize you for your tireless service, your infectious enthusiasm, your boundless love, and for lighting and fanning the flame of faith in so many. Thank you. There's that from you. And then also as a family, we put together a little retirement gift for you to do with what you see fit. We appreciate all the help and dedication you've done over the years. I would also like to acknowledge that Kelly Lawson is going to be a new member to our church staff. So after service, we're going to have coffee, lemonade, and some cake downstairs. So if you'd like to visit with Kevin and Michelle, and wish Michelle good luck because she'll see more of Kevin now. is there anything you would like to say at this time?
Just thank you for making me feel welcome when I started and giving me the encouragement to stay for 21 years. And it really was a family ordeal. The kids helped a lot too. Good work ethic
from this building.
So, thank you.
Thank you so much.
What other joys do you have in your lives that you'd like to share this week? Okay. Vicki, I believe last week we thought she was going to be in the hospital for several weeks when we were here, but as it turns out, they were able to do daily treatments. So she is home, and we're glad for that. She's been to the doctor for some more exams and also has the ramp put in, so we're grateful for that also. What other joys do you have today? At Joyce. Oh, happy birthday, Joyce. We just talked about she lost a sister this week. In Australia, but she's celebrating her birthday. I think she said 101? No, 93. So we give thanks for all of her years. Do you have concerns that you'd like to lift up? I'll start with a couple. My Uncle Ron passed away yesterday from complications of COVID. The young woman for whom we've been praying the last 2 or 3 weeks, that was a friend of Robin's sister. She passed away this week from complications of COVID. So we want to lift up those families. Also, Pastor Joel Sutton from Manning and Manila suffered a massive heart attack on Monday, and we had his funeral service yesterday. So not only his family, he leaves a child as young, and the youngest child is starting high school next year. Not only the family, but also the churches. It's real hard on churches to have a sudden loss like that, so they're reeling as well. This week we'll be celebrating the service of death and resurrection for Sissy, so that's on Friday morning. What other concerns do you have? Okay, Barb Heston, that's Noah's grandma, on the other side, has some health problems, complications. I hear she's already half grown, but we're glad that she came in to join us. The last joy I want to share with you today before we join in prayer is just an encouragement to remember those who have shared their lives with our country and made the ultimate sacrifice for us. This Memorial Day weekend, we remember those in our family who've died, but also special remembrance for those who have served in our military. So we lift all of those families up as well. Would you pray with me? Glorious God, we give you thanks that through the power of your Holy Spirit, we have claimed as your people changed lives, changed personal lives, changed social lives. We seek to change the culture around us, to influence the people who live next to us, the people we meet each week, to influence them toward forgiveness and love and grace. Lord, open eyes so that blindness will be healed. Open hearts so that stone-cold hearts can be softened. Open our mouths that we may share the glory of your salvation. In your world, O Lord, we know that you seek peace. Peace among nations, peace among peoples. We remember those who have fought and died for peace this day. And we pray for those who continue to seek peace through all means possible. Because you are a God who does dream of peace in our world and uses us to achieve that. Lord, we remember that you are a God who gives your church a job. And that job is to not only reach out and share the gospel, but also to teach our young ones. We know that Vacation Bible School will be coming up very soon. We pray for teachers and leaders and for children and families as they begin to plan for that week of Vacation Bible School. We pray for all those who are beginning their small groups, the men's group and the sewing group and all the other groups in our church, knowing that their work has been missed and they've missed each other. Help us to be the people who make a difference in very small ways sometimes, but make a difference in the world around us. Lord, receive our petitions for those who are grieving, these families who have lost loved ones. Also, our petitions for healing. Stand with those who need your healing this day. Accompany those who are in prison or awaiting trial. Give strength to your church as we stand against the challenges that seek to marginalize us. Give us love to receive and embrace those who are different from ourselves. Give us hope that working hand in hand with you, that tomorrow can be better than today, as your kingdom comes and as your will is done in our lives and in our world. Receive our worship, our prayers, our singing, our hearing, as we ourselves offer our lives to you today. All of this we pray in the name of the Prince of Peace. And we pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The scripture today is from Acts 9, verses 1 through 19. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found anyone who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? He asked, Who are you, Lord? The reply came, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do. The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, Ananias, he answered, Here I am, Lord. The Lord said to him, Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen a vision of a man named Ananias coming in and laying his hands on him so that he might regain his sight. But Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to our saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name. But the Lord said to him, Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name. So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up, was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength.
How many of you enjoy sinning? Nobody? Nobody's willing to raise their hand? Well, there you go. We got one truthful person here, because you see, sin, if weren't tempting us to do something that we like, something that we enjoy, something that feels good, even though we know it's wrong, it wouldn't be a temptation, would it? James says, each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desires. Not from outside of us, it's our own evil desires. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's full grown, gives birth to death. Temptation is only temptation when it's tempting us to do something we like to do. And if we fall to temptation and sin, it's because we like to do that. So in a way, in a warped kind of way, we all enjoy sin, even though we know we shouldn't do it. Who among us, for instance, doesn't enjoy a little gluttony once in a while at Pizza Ranch, right? We all like that. Or who among us has considered maybe not forgiving someone just because we've got some power over them? We can be tempted to do that. Or who among us doesn't like stuff? And stuff is okay unless it comes from greed or maybe from theft. It's okay to have that stuff, though. Who among us wouldn't want to have that kind of stuff? Who among us doesn't like to have those things or do those things? In a warped kind of way, we have to admit, at least in our hearts, that we sin because we want to and because we enjoy it. Now, it's a strange way to think about sin, but think about Paul now. Paul was doing what he thought was right. He thought he was doing the righteous thing. He thought he was in the right. He thought he was doing the thing that he should do. He was doing the thing that he enjoyed. He was persecuting the church from our perspective. From his perspective, he was defending his faith. He was defending what he thought was true against what he thought was false. So he was doing the right thing, and he was enjoying doing that. We go to his story, and we see that Paul, when we first met him, was holding the coats when Stephen was stoned. And then we see Paul breathing thoughts of murder against the way. And that's what he called the Christians, the way. And then we see that Paul is so concerned about Christianity spreading around the world that he gets a letter that he can carry to Damascus himself that's basically an arrest warrant for all the Christians. So Paul wanted so much to have that done that he actually carried himself. 6-day trip to Damascus, and he took it himself. When he was almost there, and I interpret that to be maybe day 5 or day 6, and when he was almost there, a light came from heaven, and he's knocked off his horse. Now, I don't know. I always kind of thought that God knocked him off his horse when I was a kid, but that's not what the Bible says. Maybe he fell off because he was startled. Maybe he fell off because he realized this was God, and he wanted to get to the ground and kneel in worship. Maybe he fell off because he kind of had that tuck and roll kind of instinct to preserve his life. But at any rate, Paul finds himself on the ground. And if he realizes this is God, remember, he's doing what he thinks is right. He's doing what he thinks is absolutely right. Once he realizes this is God, he probably expects a pat on the back, doesn't he? Well done, good and faithful Pharisee, right? Well done, my son. That's not what he gets. That's not what he gets at all. Paul hears a voice. The voice says, I'm Saul. Saul, I'm sorry. Saul hears this voice, says, Saul, Saul. Just calm down, he says. Saul, Saul. Why do you persecute me? God cuts right to the core of the issue. Why do you persecute me? He says, well, who is this? And he finds out that it's Jesus. Right in the middle of his sinning, right in the middle of his going to arrest more Christians, right in the middle of his persecuting the church, God appears to change him. Now, most of us are not going to see a big flash of light and fall off of our horse. But I guarantee you, in the midst of our sinning, when you're having the most fun you think you can have, that's when God comes to you and says, why? Why are you doing that? Now, it might not be, why are you persecuting me? But maybe it's, why are you so stingy with your resources and your time? Maybe it's, why? Why are you so slow to forgive those around you? Maybe the question for you is why? Why can't you share more of yourself with those around you? Maybe the question for you is why? Why can't you commit to doing the things that you know is right when someone asks you for help? Why? Why? in the midst of our sin, when we least expect to find God, when in fact we might be pushing God away as far as possible, in the midst of our sin, that's when the Holy Spirit comes and convicts our hearts. When you least expect and maybe least want God to interrupt your life, that's when God comes and says, "Why? Why are you doing that?" God speaks to us, sometimes at the most inconvenient moments, the moments when we'd rather that God didn't know what we were doing, the moments when we'd rather that we were doing it in the dark so that no one knew what we were doing. God comes and speaks to us when we are our most hurtful, short-sighted, disrespectful, contemptible selves. God comes to open our eyes. Paul was struck blind, but then his eyes were opened and he saw the world in a different way. We aren't struck blind, but when God comes and speaks to us, when God comes in the middle of our sin and speaks to us, he opens our eyes to see the world in a different way and see how our behavior, how our decisions are negatively affecting those around us. To see how our sin is hurting our relationship between us and God. God comes to open our eyes. God comes in the midst of our sin, the midst of our disobedience, the midst of our anger, the midst of our unforgiveness. God comes in the midst of that to convict us. Say, "Why? Why are you doing this?" And if we look up, we will see God with a broken heart and a tear in the corner of his eye, but with his arms wide open, waiting to receive us in grace. God is a good God, and God is always there. There's nothing we can do to hide from God. You know that. There's a story told about Asbury College. There was a plate of apples at the beginning of the lunch line, and on the plate of apples there was a sign that said, "Take one, only one please, God is watching." Well, some smart aleck went to the other end of the line and put a sign on the peanut butter cookies that said, "Take as many as you want, God is watching the apples." We chuckle because we know instinctively that God's watching both the apples and the peanut butter cookies. God sees us in the light and in the dark. God sees us when we're proud of what we're doing and when we're ashamed of what we're doing. God sees us when we're at our best and when we are at our worst. Psalm 139 reminds us of that. "Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you're there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me. Your right hand shall hold me fast. I say, surely darkness shall cover me, and the light around me becomes night," so that God doesn't see us. "But even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, and the darkness is light to you." My friends, when the darkness of your sin becomes unbearable to you, when the hopelessness of your spinning your wheels in sin becomes too much for you, God is right there. Wherever you are, God is there. When our sinfulness and our brokenness comes crashing down upon us, God is there, holding out the hand. And if we're ready to grasp that hand, or if we're ready to grasp out of the darkness, grasp the hand of the one who said, "Let there be light," when there had been no light, God will pick us up, transform us, care for us, and set us back on his right path. Sometimes we have to hit rock bottom before we're ready to do that, though. Sometimes we have to get to the last straw before we're willing to hear what God has to say. Friends, don't look for God just in the good times. Look for God when you know that you're doing the wrong thing. because God is there. God is speaking to you. God is transforming you. God is not afraid to jump into the deep end of our sin. God is not afraid to jump into the deepest, darkest secrets of your life. We should not be afraid to let God jump in. We should not be afraid to let God jump in and change us. There's hardly a more radical change from the Pharisee Saul to the Apostle Paul. But we can experience something of that same change in our lives. I'll tell you a story. I've been saving this for this morning. I've been visiting a fellow in jail. A fellow who's from Carroll here and had some trouble, not the first time. I became acquainted with him. I've been visiting him in jail. Gave him a Bible, I think, 2 times ago when I was there. We talked about the Gospel of Luke. We talked about Jeremiah. And he's been hanging on to the passage from Jeremiah that says, I have good things for you. God has good plans for you. And he said, I'm stuck on that. And the part of it that he was stuck on is when you are desperate enough, the way he put it, it's not the way the Bible says it, when you're desperate enough to want God, God will be there. I asked him, how desperate are you? He said, right now, pretty desperate. We, right there in the visitor's room of the Greene County Jail, prayed a prayer asking Jesus into his heart. He's at the lowest point right now, waiting for likely conviction and sentencing. But he's willing to let God into that darkness, to let God into that jail cell, to let God into his heart so that he can be a different person when this is all over. We can do that too. Keep him in prayer as I go to visit him in 2 weeks because he's asking to be baptized. So I'll likely be baptizing him in the jail cell in 2 weeks. But we can let God into our lives in those times when we least want God, when we're most ashamed of what we're doing, because God wants to be there and God can change us. Let's pray. Persistent and ever hopeful God, we invite you into the darkest, most secret parts of our lives, things we don't want any human being to know. We share with you because we know that you are going to be there anyway. Forgive us, reclaim us, and in grace, raise us up with all your people. Set us on your path of healing and righteousness. Hold us close so that we do not stray again. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In the beginning, your Spirit moved over the face of the waters. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. Your Spirit came upon the prophets and teachers, anointing them to speak your word. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise you and join in their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Holy God, and your Son, Jesus Christ. At his baptism in the Jordan, your Spirit descended upon him. With your Spirit upon him, he turned away the temptation of sin. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, baptizing us with the Holy Spirit and with fire, as on the day of Pentecost. On the day when Jesus gave himself up for us, he was with his disciples, and he took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and having given thanks, he gave it to them, and he said, "Drink you all of this, for this is my cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood and empowered by the gifts of your Holy Spirit. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. The body of Christ, broken for you. And the blood of Christ shed for you. Any others? God, we give you thanks for this meal, for these people, for your presence in this place, as we are filled with your Spirit this day. In your name we pray. Amen. As weave, let's stand and sing.
Weave us together.
Now may God go with you. May God fill you. May God transform you. May God make you into the person God wants you to be. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.